makes the day that lasts away. By mid-afternoon, the black Chevrolet had reached Emporia, Kansas. A large town, almost a city, and a safe place. So the occupants of the car had decided to do a bit of shopping. They parked on a side street, then wandered about until a suitably crowded variety store presented itself. The first purchase was a pair of rubber gloves. These were for Perry, who, unlike Dick, had neglected to bring old gloves of his own. They moved on to a counter displaying women's hosiery. After a spell of indecisive quibbling, Perry said, "I'm for it." Dick was not. "What about my eye? They're all too light-coloured to hide that." "Miss," said Perry, attracting a salesgirl's attention, "you got any black stockings?" When she told him no, he proposed they try another store. Black's foolproof. But Dick had made up his mind. Stockings of any shade were unnecessary, an encumbrance, a useless expense. "I've already invested enough money in this operation." And after all, anyone who they encountered would not live to bear witness. "No witnesses," he reminded Perry. For what seemed to Perry the millionth time, it rankled in him, the way Dick mouthed these two words as though they solved every problem. It was stupid not to admit that there might be a witness they hadn't seen. "The inevitable happens. Things do take a turn," he said. But Dick, smiling boastfully, boyishly, did not agree. "Get the bubbles out of your blood. Nothing can go wrong." No, because the plan was Dick's. And from first footfall to final silence, flawlessly devised. Next, they were interested in rope. Perry studied the stock and tested it. Having once served in the Merchant Marine, he understood rope and was clever with knots. He chose a white nylon cord, as strong as wire and not much thicker. They discussed how many yards of it they required. The question irritated Dick, for it was part of a greater quandary, and he could not, despite the alleged perfection of his overall design, be certain of the answer. They eventually said, "Christ, how the hell should I know?" "You're damn well better," Dick tried. "There's him, her, the kid, and the girl. Maybe the other two, but it's Saturday. They might have guests. Let's count on 8. Or even 12. Only sure thing is every one of them has got to go." "Seems a lot of it to be so sure about. Ain't that what I promised you, honey? Plenty of hair in them those walls." Perry shrugged. "Then we'd better buy the whole roll." It was 100 yards long, quite enough for 12. Kenyon had built the chest himself, a mahogany hope chest, lined with cedar, which he intended to give Beverly as a wedding present. Now, working on it, in the so-called den in the basement, he applied a last coat of varnish. The furniture of the den, a cement-floored room that ran the length of the house, consisted almost entirely of examples of his carpentry. Shelves, tables, stools, a ping-pong table, and Nancy's needlework. Chintz slipcovers that rejuvenated a decrepit couch, curtains, pillows bearing legends. "Happy? And you don't have to be crazy to love here, live here, but it helps." Together, Kenyon and Nancy had made a paint-splattered attempt to deprive the basement room of its unremovable dourness, and neither was aware of failure. In fact, they both thought their den was a triumph and a blessing. Nancy, because it was a place where she could entertain the gang without disturbing her mother, and Kenyon, because here he could be alone, free to bang, saw, and mess with his inventions, the newest of which was an electric deep-dish frying pan. Adjoining the den was a furnace room which contained a tool-littered table piled with some of his other works in progress, an amplifying unit, an elderly wind-up Victorola which he was restoring to service. Kenyon resembled neither of his parents physically. His crew-cut hair was hemp-coloured. He was 6 feet tall and lanky, though hefty enough to have once rescued a pair of full-grown sheep by carrying them 2 miles through a blizzard. Sturdy, strong, but cursed with a lanky boy's lack of muscular coordination. This defect, aggravated by an inability to function without glasses, prevented him from taking more than a token part in those team sports, basketball and baseball, that were the main occupation of most of the boys who might have been his friends. He had only one close friend, Bob Jones, the son of Taylor Jones, whose ranch was a mile west of the Clutter home. Out in rural Kansas, boys start driving cars very young. Kenyon was 11 when his father allowed him to buy, with money he had earned raising sheep, an old truck with a Model A engine, the Coyote Wagon, he and Bob called it. Not far from River Valley Farm, there's a mysterious stretch of countryside known as the Sand Hills. It's like a beach without an ocean. And at night, coyotes slink among the dunes, assembling in hordes to howl. On moonlit evenings, the boys would descend upon them, set them running, try to outrace them in the wagon. They seldom did, for the scrawniest coyote can hit 50 miles an hour, whereas the wagon's top speed was 35. But it was a wild and beautiful kind of fun, the wagon skidding across the sand, the fleeing coyotes framed against the moon. As Bob said, it sure made your heart hurry. Equally intoxicating and more profitable were the rabbit roundups the two boys conducted. Kenyon was a good shot and his friend a better one, and between them they sometimes delivered 50 rabbits to the rabbit factory, a Garden City processing plant that paid 10 cents a head for the animals, which were then quick frozen and shipped to mink growers. But what meant most to Kenyon and Bob too was their weekend, overnight hunting hikes along the shores of the river, wandering, wrapping up in blankets, listening at sunrise for the noise of wings, moving towards the sound on tiptoe, and then, sweetest of all, swaggering homeward with a dozen duck dinners swinging from their belts. But lately things had changed between Kenyon and his friend. They hadn't quarrelled. There'd been no overt falling out. Nothing had happened, except that Bob, who was 16, had started going with a girl, which meant that Kenyon, a year younger, and still very much the adolescent bachelor, could no longer count on his companionship. Bob told him, when you're my age, you'll feel different. I used to think the same as you. Women, so what? But then you get to talking to some woman, and it's mighty nice, you'll see. Kenyon doubted it. He could not conceive of ever wanting to waste an hour on any girl that might be spent on guns, horses, tools, machinery, even a book. If Bob was unavailable, then he'd rather be alone, for in temperament he was not in the least Mr. Clutter's son, but rather Bonnie's child, a sensitive and reticent boy. His contemporaries thought him standoffish, yet forgave him, saying, "Oh, Kenyon, it's just that he lives in a world of his own." Leaving the varnish to dry, he went on to another chore, one that took him out of doors. He wanted to tidy up his mother's flower garden, a treasured patch of dishevelled foliage that grew beneath her bedroom window. When he got there, he found one of the hired men loosening earth with a spade, Paul Helm, the husband of the housekeeper. "Seen that car?" Mr. Helm asked. Yes. Kenyon had seen a car in the driveway, a grey Buick, standing outside the entrance to his father's office. "Thought you might know who it was." "Nonetheless, it's Mr. Johnson. Dad said he was expecting him." Mr. Helm, the late Mr. Helm, he died of a stroke the following March, was a sombre man in his late 50s, whose withdrawn manner veiled a nature keenly curious and watchful. He liked to know what was going on. "Which Johnson?" "Oh, the insurance fellow." Mr. Helm grunted. "Your dad must be laying in a stack of it. That car's been here, I'd say, 3 hours. The chill of oncoming dusk shivered through the air, and though the sky was still deep blue, lengthening shadows emanated from the garden's tall chrysanthemum stalks. Nancy's cat frolicked among them, catching its paws in the twine with which Kenyon and the old man were now tying plants. Suddenly Nancy herself came jogging across the fields aboard Fat Babe. Babe, returning from her Saturday treat, a bathe in the river. Teddy the dog accompanied them, and all three were water-splashed and shining. "You'll catch cold," Mr. Helms said. Nancy laughed. She'd never been ill. Not once. Sliding off Babe, she sprawled on the grass at the edge of the garden and seized her cat, dangled him above her, kissed his nose and whiskers. Kenyon was disgusted. "Kissing animals on the mouth!" "You used to kiss Skeeter," she reminded him. Skeeter was a horse. A beautiful horse. A strawberry stallion he'd raised from a foal. How that Skeeter could take offence. "You use a horse too hard," his father had cautioned him. "One day you'll ride the life out of Skeeter." And he had. While Skeeter was streaking down a road with his master astride him, his heart failed, and he stumbled, and was dead. Now, a year later, Kenyon still mourned him, even though his father, taking pity on him, had promised him the pick of next spring's foals. "Kenyon," Nancy said, "do you think Tracy will be able to talk by Thanksgiving?" Tracy, not yet a year old, was her nephew, the son of Eviana, the sister to whom she felt particularly close. Beverly was Kenyon's favourite. "It would thrill me to pieces to hear him say Aunt Nancy or Uncle Kenyon. Wouldn't you like to hear him say that? I mean, don't you love being an uncle, Kenyon? Good grief, why can't you ever answer me?" "Because you're silly," he said, tossing her the head of a flower, a wilted dahlia, which she jammed into her hair. Mr. Helm picked up his spade. Crows cawed, sundown was near, but his home was not. The lane of Chinese elms had turned into a tunnel of darkening green, and he lived at the end of it, half a mile away. "Evening," he said, and started his journey. But once he looked back, "and that," he was to testify the next day, "was the last I seen them. Nancy leading old Babe off to the barn. Like I said, nothing out of the ordinary." The black Chevrolet was again parked, this time in front of a Catholic hospital on the outskirts of Emporia. Under continued needling. "That's your trouble. You think there's only one right way, Dick's way." Dick had surrendered. While Perry waited in the car, he had gone into the hospital to try and buy a pair of black stockings from a nun. This rather unorthodox method of obtaining them had been Perry's inspiration. Nuns, he'd argued, were certain to have a supply. The notion presented one drawback, of course. Nuns and anything pertaining to them were bad luck, and Perry was most respectful of this superstition. Some others were number 15, red hair, white flowers, priests crossing a road, snakes appearing in a dream. Still, it couldn't be helped. The compulsively superstitious person is also very often a serious believer in fate. That was the case with Perry. He was here and embarked on the present errand, not because he wished to be, but because fate had arranged the matter. He could prove it, though he had no intention of doing so, or at least within Dick's hearing, for the proof would involve his confessing the true and secret motive behind his return to Kansas, a piece of parole violation he had decided upon for a reason quite unrelated to Dick's score, or Dick's summoning letter. The reason was that several weeks earlier he had learned that on Thursday, November 12th, another of his former cellmates was being released from Kansas State Penitentiary at Lansing, and more than anything in the world, he desired a reunion with this man, his real and only friend, the brilliant Willie J. During the first of his 3 years in prison, Perry had observed Willie J. from a distance, with interest but with apprehension. If one wished to be thought a tough specimen, intimacy with Willie J. seemed unwise. He was the chaplain's clerk, a slender Irishman with prematurely grey hair and grey, melancholy eyes. His tenor voice was the glory of the prison's choir. Even Perry, though he was contemptuous of any exhibition of piety, felt upset when he heard Willie J. sing the Lord's Prayer, the hymn's grave language sung in so credulous a spirit moved him. made him wonder a little at the justice of his contempt. Eventually, prodded by a slightly alerted religious curiosity, he approached Willie J, and the chaplain's clerk, at once responsive, thought he divined, in the cripple-legged bodybuilder with the misty gaze and the prim, smoky voice, a poet, something rare and savourable, an ambition to bring this boy to God, engulfed him. His hopes of succeeding accelerated when one day Perry produced a pastel drawing he had made, a large, in no way technically naive portrait of Jesus. Lansing's Protestant chaplain, the Reverend James Post, so valued it that he hung it in his office, where it hangs still, a slick and pretty saviour, with Willie J's full lips and grieving eyes. The picture was the climax of Perry's never very earnest spiritual quest, and ironically, the termination of it. He had judged his Jesus a piece of hypocrisy, an attempt to fool and betray Willie J, for he was unconvinced of God, as ever. Yet, should he admit this, and risk forfeiting the one friend who had ever truly understood him? Hard, Joe, Jesse, travellers straying through a world where last names were seldom exchanged, these had been his buddies, never anyone like Willie J, who was, in Perry's opinion, way above average intellectually, perceptively, as a well-trained psychologist. How is it possible that so gifted a man had wound up in Lansing? That was what amazed Perry. The answer, which he knew but rejected as an evasion of the deeper, the human question, was plain to simpler minds. The chaplain's clerk, then 38, was a thief, a small-scale robber, who over a period of 20 years had served sentences in 5 different states. Perry decided to speak out. He was sorry, but it was not for him. Heaven, hell, saints, divine mercy. And if Willie J's affection was founded on the prospect of Perry's someday joining him at the foot of the cross, then he was deceived, and their friendship false, a counterfeit, like the portrait. As usual, Willie J understood. Disheartened but not disenchanted, he had persisted in courting Perry's soul until the day of its possessor's parole and departure, on the eve of which he wrote Perry a farewell letter, whose last paragraph ran, "You are a man of extreme passion, a hungry man, not quite sure where his appetite lies, a deeply frustrated man striving to project his individuality against a backdrop of rigid conformity. You exist in a half-world suspended between 2 superstructures, one self-expression and the other self-destruction. You are strong, but there is a flaw in your strength, and unless you learn to control it, the flaw will prove stronger than your strength and defeat you. The flaw? Explosive emotional reaction out of all proportion to the occasion. Why? Why this unreasonable anger at the sight of others who are happy or content? This growing contempt for people and the desire to hurt them? All right, you think they're fools. You despise them because their morals, their happiness, is the source of your frustration and resentment. But these are dreadful enemies you carry within yourself, in time destructive as bullets. Mercifully, a bullet kills its victim. This other bacteria, permitted to age, does not kill a man, but leaves in its wake the hulk of a creature torn and twisted. There is still fire within his being, but it is kept alive by casting upon it faggots of scorn and hate. He may successfully accumulate, but he does not accumulate success. For he is his own enemy and is kept from truly enjoying his achievements." Perry, flattered to be the subject of this sermon, had let Dick read it, and Dick, who took a dim view of Willie J, had called the letter, "Just more of Billy Graham Cracker's hooey," adding, "Faggots of scorn, he's the faggot." Of course, Perry had expected this reaction, and secretly he welcomed it. His friendship with Dick, whom he had scarcely known until his final few months in Lansing, was an outgrowth of, and counterbalance to, the intensity of his admiration for the chaplain's clerk. Perhaps Dick was shallow, or even, as Willie J. claimed, a vicious blusterer. All the same, Dick was full of fun, and he was shrewd, a realist. He cut through things. There were no clouds in his head or straw in his hair. Moreover, unlike Willie J., he was not critical of Perry's exotic aspirations. He was willing to listen, catch fire, share with him those visions of guaranteed treasure lurking in Mexican seas, Brazilian jungles. After Perry's parole, 4 months elapsed. Months of rattling around in a fifth-hand $100 Ford, rolling from Reno to Las Vegas, from Bellingham, Washington to Boole, Idaho. And it was in Boole, where he'd found temporary work as a truck driver, that Dick's letter had reached him. "Friend P. came out in August, and after you left I met someone. You do not know him, but he put me onto something. We could bring off it beautiful. A cinch. The perfect score." Until then, Perry had not imagined that he'd ever see Dick again, or Willie J., but they'd both been much in his thoughts, and especially the latter, who, in memory, had grown 10 feet tall, a grey-haired, wise man, haunting the hallways of his mind. "You pursue the negative," Willie J. had informed him once, in one of his lectures. "You want not to give a damn, to exist without responsibility, without faith or friends or warmth." In the solitary, comfortless course of his recent driftings, Perry had over and over again reviewed this indictment, and had decided it was unjust. He did give a damn. But who had ever given a damn about him? His father? Oh, yes, up to a point. A girl or two? Well, that was a long story. No one else except Willie J. himself. And only Willie J. had ever recognised his worth, his potentialities, had acknowledged that he was not just an undersized, overmuscled half-breed, had seen him, for all the moralising, as he saw himself. Exceptional. Rare. Artistic. In Willie J., his vanity had found support. His sensibility, shelter, and the four-month exile from his high-carat appreciation had made it more alluring than any dream of buried gold. So when he received Dick's invitation, and realised that the date Dick proposed for his coming to Kansas more or less coincided with the time of Willie J.'s release, he knew what he must do. He drove to Las Vegas, sold his junk heap car, packed his collection of maps, old letters, manuscripts and books, and bought a ticket for the Greyhound bus. The journey's aftermath was up to fate. If things didn't work out with Willie J., then he might consider Dick's proposition. As it turned out, the choice was between Dick and nothing. For when Perry's bus reached Kansas City on the evening of November the 12th, Willie J., whom he had been unable to advise of his coming, had already left town. Left, in fact, only 5 hours earlier, from the same terminal at which Perry arrived. That much he had learned by telephoning the Reverend Mr. Post, who further discouraged him by declining to reveal his former clerk's exact destination. "He's headed east," the chaplain said, "to fine opportunities, a decent job, and a home with some good people who are willing to help him." And Perry, hanging up, had felt dizzy with anger and disappointment. But what, he wondered, when the anguish subsided, had he really expected from a reunion with Willie J.? Freedom had separated them. As free men, they had nothing in common. They were opposites, who could never have formed a team, certainly not one capable of embarking on the skin-diving south-of-the-border adventures that he and Dick had plotted. Nevertheless, if he had not missed Willie J., if they could have been together for even an hour, Perry was quite convinced he just knew that he would not now be loitering outside a hospital waiting for Dick to emerge with a pair of black stockings. Dick returned empty-handed. "No go," he announced, with a furtive casualness that made Perry suspicious. "Are you sure? Sure you even asked?" "Sure I did." "I don't believe you. I think you went in there, hung around a couple of minutes and came out." "Okay, sugar, whatever you say." Dick started the car. After they'd travelled in silence a while, Dick patted Perry on the knee. "Oh, come on," he said. "It was a pukey idea. What the hell would they have thought? Me barging in there like it was a goddamn five and dime?" Perry said, "Maybe it's just as well. Nuns are a bad luck bunch." The Garden City representative of New York Life Insurance smiled as he watched Mr. Clutter uncap a Parker pen and open a checkbook. He was reminded of a local jest. "Know what they say about you, Herb? Say, since haircuts went to $1.50, Herb writes the barber a check." "That's correct," replied Mr. Clutter, like royalty. He was famous for never carrying cash. "That's the way I do business. When those tax fellows come poking around, cancelled checks are your best friend." With the check written but not yet signed, he swiveled back in his desk chair and seemed to ponder. The agent, a stocky, somewhat bald, rather informal man named Bob Johnson, hoped his client wasn't having last-minute doubts. Herb was hard-headed, a slow man to make a deal. Johnson had worked over a year to clinch this sale. But no, his customer was merely experiencing what Johnson called the solemn moment, a phenomenon familiar to insurance salesmen. The mood of a man insuring his life is not unlike that of a man signing his will. Thoughts of mortality must occur. "Yes, yes," said Mr. Clutter, as though conversing with himself. "I've plenty to be grateful for, wonderful things in my life." Framed documents commemorating milestones in his career gleamed against the walnut walls of his office. A college diploma, a map of River Valley Farm, agricultural awards, an ornate certificate bearing the signatures of Dwight D. Eisenhower and John Foster Dulles, which cited his service to the Federal Farm Credit Board. "The kids. We've been lucky there. Shouldn't say it, but I'm real proud of them. Take Kenyon. Right now he kind of leans towards being an engineer or a scientist. But you can't tell me my boy's not a born rancher. God willing, he'll run this place some day. You ever met Eviana's husband, Don Jarchow, veterinarian? I can't tell you how much I think of that boy. Veer, too. Veer English. The boy my girl Beverly had the good sense to settle on. If anything ever happened to me, I'm sure I could trust those fellows to take responsibility. Bonnie by herself? Oh, Bonnie wouldn't be able to carry on an operation like this." Johnson, a veteran of listening to ruminations of this sort, knew it was time to intervene. "Why, Herb," he said, "you're a young man, 48, and from the looks of you, from what the medical report tells us, we're likely to have you around a couple of weeks more." Mr. Clutter straightened, reached again for his pen. "Tell the truth, I feel pretty good and pretty optimistic. I've got an idea a man could make some real money round here the next few years." While outlining his schemes for future financial betterment, he signed the check and pushed it across the desk. The time was 6:10 and the agent was anxious to go. His wife would be waiting supper. "It's been a pleasure, Herb."
"Same here, fellow."
They shook hands, then with a merited sense of victory, Johnson picked up Mr. Clutter's check and deposited it in his billfold. It was the first payment on a $40,000 policy that, in the event of death by accidental means, paid double indemnity. "And he walks with me, he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known." With the aid of his guitar, Perry had sung himself into a happier humour. He knew the lyrics of some 200 hymns and ballads, a repertoire ranging from The Old Rugged Cross to Cole Porter, and in addition to the guitar, he could play the harmonica, the accordion, the banjo, and the xylophone. In one of his favourite theatrical fantasies, his stage name was Perry O'Parsons, a star who billed himself as the one-man symphony. Dick said, "How about a cocktail?" Personally, Perry didn't care what he drank, for he was not much of a drinker. Dick, however, was choosy, and in bars his usual choice was an orange blossom. From the car's glove compartment, Perry fetched a pint bottle containing a ready-mixed compound of orange flavouring and vodka. They passed the bottle to and fro. Though dusk had established itself, Dick, doing a steady 60 miles an hour, was still driving without headlights. But then the road was straight, the country was as level as a lake, and other cars were seldom sighted. This was out there, or getting near it. "Christ," said Perry, glaring at the landscape, flat and limitless under the sky's cold, lingering, green, empty and lonesome except for the far between flickerings of farmhouse lights. He hated it, as he hated the Texas plains, the Nevada desert. Spaces horizontal and sparsely inhabited had always induced in him a depression accompanied by agoraphobic sensations. Seaports were his heart's delight. Crowded, clanging, ship-clogged, sewage-scented cities like Yokohama, where as an American army private he'd spent a summer during the Korean War. "Christ, they told me to keep away from Kansas. Never set my pretty foot here again, as though they were barring me from heaven. Just look at it. Just feast your eyes." Dick handed in the bottle, the contents reduced by half. "Save the rest," Dick said. "We may need it." "Remember, Dick, all that talk about getting a boat?" "I was thinking we could buy a boat in Mexico, something cheap but sturdy. We could go to Japan, sail right across the Pacific. It's been done. Thousands of people have done it. And I'm not conning you, Dick. You'd go for Japan. Wonderful, gentle people with manners like flowers. Really considerate. Not just out for your dough. And the women. You never met a real woman." "Yes, I have," said Dick, who claimed still to be in love with his honey blonde first wife, though she had remarried. "There are these baths. One place called the Dream Pool. You stretch out and beautiful knockout type girls come and scrub you head to toe." "You told me." Dick's tone was curt. "So, can't I repeat myself? Later. Let's talk about it later. Hell, man, I've got plenty on my mind." Dick switched on the radio. Perry switched it off. Ignoring Dick's protest, he strummed his guitar. "I came to the garden alone while the dew was still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses." A full moon was forming at the edge of the sky.